So this is the last lecture of Marcus then?
Okay, so this is my last lecture, and I have to say that I'm quite shocked because I have been slower than when I gave these lectures on a Blackboard. So I've been really slow. So now I have to, so now my plan now is to do half an hour of localization of ABGN theory, and then half an hour of how to eventually recover the strong coupling result from the gauge theory. So I might have to drop some slides, so don't panic. I'm going to try to be coherent, even if I have to be fast. So these things are not contradicting each other, so I will try to do it. Okay, so let's now, so the last thing we saw is how to, oops, is this on? I think this, okay, yeah. So let's try to apply the program of localization to the theory we're interested on, which is ABGN theory. So the first, as a warming up, and probably I will give most of the details here, and then I will probably show you the result for ABGN, we are going to do the localization for Superchern-Simons theory. Okay? So this was done first by a very nice paper by Kapustin, Willett, and Jacob. And what they did is, okay, they took the general framework I gave you before, and they applied it to this theory. So what do we need? Okay, well, first of all, we need a Grassmann symmetry. But we are lucky because supersymmetric theories have lots of Grassmann symmetries. Now, remember that when I was writing the transformations of this theory, there were two supersymmetric parameters, epsilon and epsilon bar, and actually you can see that you have actually two supersymmetries here, so you can choose any of them as a Grassmann symmetry. So let me define delta epsilon as epsilon times Q, and this will be my Grassmannian symmetry here. If you look at the supersymmetry transformation that I was showing you before, it's very easy to see that here actually the Grassmann symmetry is as easy as it can get because the square is actually to zero. Okay? So we have a Grassmann symmetry in the theory, and this is the key thing of supersymmetry. Supersymmetry is giving the Grassmann symmetry we need. Now we have to pick a V. Okay? And we have to pick a V in such a way that when Q acts on V, we get the perturbing turn of the action, and this should have positive definite part, okay, at the level of the bosonic fields. Now, it turns out that the superjamming action can be written as Q of something, okay? This is something that you can see very easily. If you're familiar with superspace techniques, this actually typically follows from being able to write a Lagrangian in superspace. When you can write a Lagrangian in superspace, typically you can write it as Q or something. And this, you can actually check it in detail. If you look at the paper by Kapustin, Willett, and Jakob, they do all the computation in detail. So actually, this is a nice way of perturbing my theory, which is not superjamming. My theory is super Chern-Simons theory. So I'm going to perturb the theory with T times QV, which means here T times supersymmetric Jamming. Now, the bosonic part of this guy is positive. And this was something I mentioned, but maybe I can remind you. So there are three bosonic terms here. One is F mu nu, F mu nu, which is definitely positive. The other is d mu sigma, which is also positive. And finally, you have the d plus sigma over r squared, which is also positive. So these are the three bosonic terms of this supersymmetric Jamming action, and they are both positive definite, so we are in business, okay? Good. So we now then look at this supersymmetric partition function. We have our super Chern-Simons theory with its coupling, and then we perturb with this guy. Now the bosonic part, we have to remember when t goes to infinity, the path integral will localize on the zero locus of the bosonic part. That's why we choose a bosonic part which is positive definite. Okay? Now, when are these guys zero? Well, since this is a sum of squares, essentially, the action is a sum of these three squares, each of them has to vanish independently, and we have these three equations. M mu is zero, d mu sigma is zero, and d plus sigma over r is zero. R is the radius of the three sphere. Now, what is this first equation saying? Well, this is an equation which actually appeared also in the lecture by Rajesh. Today, this is telling you that the flat the connection is flat. Okay. Now, if you are in a... This is, you want the instanton equation in three dimensions. Now, the instanton equation in four dimensions on a four sphere has tons of solutions. But the flat connection condition on a three sphere is actually only has one non-trivial solution. Well, it's actually only has the trivial solution, which is A equals zero. This is very important. This means that there are no instantons in this theory. Okay? Actually, one of the main problems of localization is that even though sometimes you get restricted to a finite set of configurations, if the theory has instantons, you have tons of things to deal with. You have all the instantons to deal with. So this happens, for example, in n equal 2 superjamils. N equal 2 superjamils, localization computation will give you an infinite sum over instantons, as in Necrosov calculation. Here you are very lucky because you don't have any instanton, just for topological reasons. On the 3 sphere, there are no non-trivial flat connections. So first thing, A equals 0. Now, once A equals 0, then this is a standard derivative, and then, you know, the only solution is that sigma is a constant. So, second good thing, the scalar field sigma has to be a constant scalar field. Now, once you solve this, you go here, and this is also a constant given by minus sigma 0 over R. So, we reduce the full integration over field space to an integral over a single non-trivial quantity, which is actually a constant. This is the miracle of localization. So this is the saddle point, the new saddle point of the theory, and we have to integrate around this saddle point. So actually this means that all bosonic fields are constant, so your path integral is no longer a path integral, it's just an ordinary integral. And this is this related miracle, which is that we have, in the end, we will be able to reduce the path integral to an ordinary matrix integral. And I mean, the integral is a matrix integral because this guy, sigma, is valued in the general representation of the gauge sphere, so it's a matrix. So we'll have to integrate over constant matrices at the end of the day. Okay. Now, remember the format I was showing you before this morning. Once you found the locus where you have to localize, the only thing you have to do is take the action, evaluate it on that locus, the action you started with, which was the Super-Chern-Simons action, and then you will have to compute one loop corrections around this locus, but just one loop, okay, nothing else. Now, this is a trivial thing to evaluate the supersymmetric Chern-Simons on this locus. The only thing that survives is this crossing term d sigma 0, and this is d as a function of sigma 0 is minus sigma 0 over r. This is a constant, and what you get here is up to some overall factors, is trace of sigma 0 squared. So this evaluated, the full action evaluated on this locus, gives you just a quadratic term for the constant field, because now this is a constant field. Now the harder part, the hardest part of in this game, is to actually evaluate these one-loop contributions coming from quadratic fluctuations. So what you have to do is to take this saddle point that we found after the perturbation, and we have to do a quadratic expansion around this fixed point and calculate the relevant determinants that will appear. So this is like a background field calculation, very simple. You expand all the fields around its saddle point plus fluctuations. Now, sigma is a constant, d is a constant, and the fluctuations are going to rescale it by square root of t, just in order to have canonical kinetic terms for these fields. Because remember, when I perturb the action, I have a t here. If I want to have canonical kinetic terms, I mean, this is not strictly necessary, but it's actually convenient to actually rescale the fields in this way. Now, A was around 0, so I'm going just to rescale it, and lambda is just a fermion, and I'm going to rescale it too, because it also comes with a T in this story here. Lambda also appears here. So when I do all this thing, what I get for the quadratic fluctuations is something like this. So you have a standard quadratic term for the gauge field. Remember that this is everything I'm doing here is the perturbing action. You remember that when I was writing this in terms of a saddle point calculation, I had to expand at a quadratic level the perturbing action. So this comes just from doing the quadratic fluctuations in the Super-Jan-Mills action around this background there. Now you have a standard kinetic term for the gauge field. You have some sort of mass term for the gauge field given by sigma 0. Sigma 0 is a constant. This is some sort of a Higgsing that you get from this field sigma 0. And then for the fermion, you get the same thing. This is the kinetic term. This is sort of mass term coming from a Higgsing coming from sigma 0. And here it is a coupling that comes from the curvature. This is something that you have to put there by hand when you are on a 3 sphere. And here, eventually, the calculation is not going to depend on the particular value of r, so I can put r equal 1 from the very beginning. Now I have to do the path integral of a quadratic theory. This is a free theory. It's very simple, but it's a gauge theory. So if you want to do things really properly, you have to do gaze fixing. Okay? Now, one very nice gaze fixing, standard one, is actually the covariant Feynman gauge. So you choose delta mu over A mu equals zero, and this means that your vector field has to be transverse. Okay? Now, there are many complications. They are nice. This is a very nice exercise of a left pop of gaze fixing you can do here. But eventually, when this dust settles, everything, the only thing you have to worry about is actually calculating this action, but just restricting yourself to transverse vector fields. There are Fadev Popov ghosts, but they turn out to cancel, the contributions from the ghost cancel against the contributions from D and sigma. So at the end of the day, you only have to worry about the quadratic terms for the gaze field, which is transverse, and the quadratic terms from the fermion field. Okay? So this is more or less clear. What is the structure of the calculation? Yeah? I mean, this is really just perturbation. It's just one loop standard perturbation theory with a non-trivial background, which is given by this constant sigma zero. So essentially, you are Higgsing the theory with this sigma zero. Okay? Okay, so at the end of the day, then, if you just remember the formula that I was writing before, you have to integrate over all saddle points, because here my saddle points are continuum. I just labeled by this constant sigma zero matrix. And now what I integrate is the all action evaluated on this fixed point times the one loop fluctuations. And you see, this is very simple. This is just the standard kinetic term plus some sort of mass terms from the gaze field and the fermions. So that's the final answer. The action for superchange Simons theorem is 3 is given by an integral over a constant field. There is a sort of action term for this sigma zero coming from superchange Simons. And then I have a complicated integrand, which are the one-loop determinants. Now, what I get here is what you call a matrix model. Why? Because we are integrating over an Hermitian constant matrix sigma zero. And remember that sigma zero is a field which is in an adjoint representation. Actually, it acts on the adjoint representation when acting on A and when acting on lambda. That's why I wrote these kind of brackets here. So the kinetic term for the gauge field is minus lambda squared acting on transverse fields plus this sort of mass term in the adjoint representation. And there is actually a residual gauge symmetry, because this guy has a gauge symmetry before, right? This guy used to transform as in the adjoint representation. And now, since it's constant, I'm only allowed to do gauge transformations which are constant matrices. A constant gauge transformation is just a matrix of UN. So what I got here is an integral over constant Hermitian matrix with a residual gauge symmetry, which just conjugates sigma zero with a UN matrix, okay? Now, once I'm here, I can still use my residual gauge symmetry, okay? Because this still has the residual gauge symmetry. And when you're dealing with matrix models, there is a very useful gauge symmetry, gauge fixing that you can do, which is not that common in gauge theories, but you can also use it, tough to use it at some point, which is called the abelian gauge. The abelian gauge means that you just diagonalize your gauge field. So this is Hermitian matrix, and I know that I can always diagonalize it by using an appropriate UN transformation. So what I'm going to do is to use this remaining gauge symmetry in order to diagonalize sigma zero, and then I'm going to write this in terms of just a set of n eigenvalues, mu1, mu2, up to mu n. Okay? So just to summarize, at the end of the day, I get an integration. The path integral collapses to a matrix integral. I have a non-trivial integrand coming especially because of the one-loop determinants, and I just have a residual gauge symmetry that allows me to write this as just a multi n-dimensional matrix integral. Okay? Is that okay? Fine? Everybody's with me? Okay. So now we have to calculate these determinants. If you want to make this precise, you have to calculate these determinants. And here again, you can use zeta function regularization. I actually advocate zeta function regularization to calculate the determinants of similar operators for the free matter multiples, and you can use the same techniques to calculate these operators. Again, this is the Dirac operator, so you know it's a spectrum on the sphere. This is the vector Laplacian acting on transverse gauge fields, which is actually something that you can also calculate very explicitly eigenvalues and so on. And you can calculate these determinants, again, using zeta function regularization. And you can look at all the details in my lecture notes. And when you do that, you actually can do it after diagonalizing this sigma zero, because the whole thing has this residual gauge symmetry.
And what you get is actually a pretty simple result. So these two determinants combine into this simple function of sigma zero, which is now diagonalized into these mu variables. So it's sine of mu i minus mu j divided by mu i minus mu j. And this product here, you can see that the structure that appears here, and doing this calculation for un, you can do it for other Gauss groups, and what is this product is actually a product over the roots of the Gauss group, okay? Yes?
Do you not have a problem with zero modes of your operators?
No, because precisely the Alpha Df Popov fixing actually removes these zero modes.
No.
Yeah. Yeah. So exactly. Yeah. So you have to be careful about when you are careful with these zero modes, essentially all the determinants are primed. So there are no. So this is this result here. But as I said, when you want to diagonalize sigma zero, you get an extra Fadev Popov determinant, which essentially comes from integrating out the off-diagonal elements of this matrix. And this gives you, if you are familiar with matrix models, this is very well-known result. When you integrate out the off-diagonal terms in a matrix integral, you get always a van der Mond determinant from this integrating out. So now you have to put together this guy, and just this action term here. So you see the result is quite simple. At the end of the day, ta-chan, you get this. So the partition function of supersymmetric terms I must see on the three sphere is given by this is the action coming from trace of sigma zero square, written in terms of mu's. Trace of sigma zero square is just, when you diagonalize, is just the sum of mu squares. And using this GS, which I introduced before with 2 pi I over k, here there is this change, and then there is a multiple integral. These prefactors can be fixed by just comparing with perturbation theory. You can just compare by these factors, keeping track of them directly is hard, but you can actually fix them by requiring that this has to reproduce weak coupling perturbation theory. Okay. So this is the result for super Chern-Simons, and this is sometimes called the Chern-Simons matrix model. Now, now you can see, well, is actually this calculation is actually good? Is actually giving me the right result? Well, actually, there is a very nice check you can do of this calculation, and the check is the following. Remember that super Chern-Simons theory has three fields, the Gauss connection, the gluino, lambda, four fields, Gauss connection, the gluino, D, and sigma. But the gluino and D and sigma were entering just in an algebraic way. They were auxiliary fields, okay? So you can integrate them out, and the theory, this super Chern-Simons theory, should be actually equivalent to a standard Chern-Simons theory, okay? Just because the fields you are adding are purely auxiliary. So with an appropriate, with a decent definition of your measure, the partition function of super Chern-Simons should be the same one as the partition function of Chern-Simons, okay? Now, Witten told us in 1998 what is the partition function of Chern-Simons on the three-sphere. So if this result of localization is actually trustable, it should agree with the result given by Witten in 1988, okay? Which I was showing you some time ago. Remember, I wrote this result for you when we were discussing this weak coupling expansion. I told you what was the partition function of a standard Chern-Simons theory in the three-sphere, and this was the result that Witten was telling us. Okay, so if this localization calculation is actually reasonable, it should reproduce this result, or you have a problem. Okay, now exercise. It's a very easy exercise if you know what you have to use. You have to use just what is called Bayes denominator formula in Lie algebra theory. You can check that this integral can be actually evaluated for finite n, and you reproduce the result of Witten. Okay? So this is, again, yet another check of localization. We have applied localization to a really interacting quantum field theory, and we have reproduced what it should be. Okay? So this is good. You are encouraged, and then you go on, because what you want to do now is to add matter. Okay? Remember that ABN theory was super transimous theory for one node, super transimous theory for other nodes, and then you have to put extra matter in between. Okay, now I have to be probably a little bit fast. And again, the story, this was done again in this paper by Kapustin, Willett, and Yakov, and then essentially generalized. I have to skip some details, but essentially the main thing that you have to use is that when you add matter, the matter Lagrangian itself, it's also exact. It's also given by key of something, okay? So when you, now you have to, what you have to add is in the matter Lagrangian, you have to add an extra parameter t prime. The original calculation is no longer for t prime equals 0. The original calculation now is for t prime equal 1. But still, you have independence with respect to t prime, as long as t prime is non-zero. Because if t prime is 0, you just are killing the Gaussian part of the integral, and then, you know, this is not good, okay? But you can definitely go to t prime going to infinity. And then you have to do again the same game with the matter, so let me skip the things. Now, the result that you get is that when you get matter, at the end of the day, if you get matter in the bifundamental representation plus a conjugate bifundamental, if you get a matter supermultiplet in the bifundamental representation plus a matter multiplet in the conjugate bifundamental representation, the effect of this is to insert this in the integral over sigma zero. Okay, this is just the effect. Okay, and actually I worked out this and showing you this for the bifundamental, but you can do it for the fundamental. You can do it for any representation of the matter. Okay. So the effect of the integral over sigma zero is remains, and then what you have is this extra insertion. Now let me actually write this because I'm thinking I'm maybe going a little bit too fast. But now if you do ABN theory, you have two nodes, UN and UN. Now here you have one vector multiplet with one sigma. Okay, let me call sigma one. And sigma 1 will localize, as before, you know, the localization for this vector multiple is the same as for supersimons, it'll be a constant. And let me call the eigenvalues of this guy mu. Now here, I do the same thing. I have a second vector multiplet, V2, with a second scalar, sigma 2, and this will also localize to sigma 0. This is localization for vector multiples that we found before, and let me call the eigenvalues of this guy new j's, say. Okay? Now, if I have bifundamentals, they will talk to mu and to nu, because they are linking the two nodes. And that's why I have here this cos of mu I and then of minus nu j to the minus 1 power. Okay, so you can see that the effect of the matter, the localization of the vector supermultiples is the same, and then adding matter is just adding extra things into these integrals. So, when you take this into account, I'm sorry I was a little fast, but the details are very similar. This also comes from doing a one-loop calculation. This is just, again, a one-loop calculation in this theory. And then, when you want to do ABN theory, what you get at the end of the day is this kind of very impressive kind of integral. So let me go through it. As I was saying, there will be two sets of eigenvalues, mu I and mu j, which come from the constant scalar for each of the nodes. So here we have mu I, and then you have mu I. Okay? The vector multiplets of un give you this sin squared that we were seeing before. Okay? So this comes from the first vector multiplet. This comes from the second vector multiplet associated to the second node. And the bifundamentals connecting the two nodes will give you two factors of this. There are four multiplets, two pairs in conjugate representations, and then there will be two factors of what I was showing you before. Two factors of this, because this is one bifundamental plus the conjugate, there are two pairs of bifundamentals, it gives you this. And then you will have this term coming from the localization of the Chern-Simons action, super-Chern-Simons action. One of them has mu squared, and the other has minus mu squared. And this is because, if you remember, when you construct this ABN theory, the two nodes have opposite gauge couplings, opposite k's. And this introduces a minus sign here. Okay? So this is the matrix integral representation that you find for the free energy of for the partition function of ABN theory on S3. Now, it's a very easy exercise to see that with coupling, you recover exactly the calculation that I was showing you before. Okay? So a weak coupling, this reproduces what you can get immediately from the Gauss theory. So now we have made the most important step in trying to make contact with the ADS prediction, which is, okay, we have drastically reduced our problem from a field theory path integral to an ordinary integral. Now, can we show that this integral, when n is large, say, and k is finite, gives this n to the 3-house behavior? Now, at least, it's still not obvious, but at least we made an important step. We have drastically reduced the problem. Okay? Now, let me mention that this I wrote it for ABGN theory, but you can actually write similar expressions for other Chern-Simons matter theories, essentially because this is like a Lego, okay? Each multiplet gives you a contribution. You have a vector multiplet, put a sin square. If you have a bifundamental, put a cos minus one. If you have a fundamental, put a cos only talking to one of the Gauss groups, etc. So if you give me a complicated Chern-Simons matter theory with many nodes, like somebody was asking me if I have 10 nodes, well, if you have 10 nodes, you will have 10 integrations over eigenvalues, and then depending on what you have in the nodes, you will have different pieces of this, okay? But you can really generalize this to whatever content you want of matter, number of nodes, etc. So it's like a Lego assembling in which each node and each matter content will give you a piece for the integral, okay? But of course, this already looks quite complicated, so now the question is, how can I extract from this expression the strong coupling behavior, okay? Now, before going to this, let me mention that you can do the same game with the n equal 4 super Jan-Mears theory that Fernando was introducing before. Now, actually, what you have to do is very similar. You put n equal 4 super Jan-Mears theory on the 4 sphere, and you use, again, as the Grassmann symmetry of localization, the supersymmetry of the theory. Okay? So there are many supersymmetries. You have to choose the appropriate ones. And actually, it turns out that the result that you find for n equal 4 super Jan-Mears is even simpler than for ABGN theory. Because here, in n equal 4 super Jan-Mears, you will find the same time of integration over a constant scalar, and this scalar, this sigma 0, is one of the 5 fields that Fernando was introducing. So again, what happens is that of all these 6 fields that appear in the adjoint representation, 5 of them will go away, and one of them will have to be a constant, and then you just have to integrate over it. But it turns out that there is nothing else in the theory but this exponential of trace of sigma 0 squared. So this is actually quite simple. It's what is called the Gaussian matrix model, and it's very simple to calculate. So in a sense, n equal 4 super Jan-Mears theory on S4 is actually a quite trivial theory. And one reason for this is that in 4 dimensions, there is something called the conformal anomaly that tells you that all the information of this partition function can actually be deduced from the conformal anomaly. And then the result, the only thing that this guy is telling you is the conformal anomaly of the 4-dimensional theory. Now, in 3 dimensions, there is no conformal anomaly. And that's why the result is much more complicated in 3 dimensions than in 4 dimensions. Now, if you include Wilson loops, you can actually do include Wilson loops in this game, and then the integral gets a very trivial modification. Essentially, what happens is that if you put a Wilson loop in the fundamental representation, so if you want to calculate the vacuum expectation value of a Wilson loop in the fundamental representation, what you have to do, let me call this 1 over z, and now you will have to do the same integration with this Gaussian weight, trace of sigma 0 squared. Let me not write the coefficient here. And then what you have to take here is the trace of e to the sigma 0. So inserting a Wilson loop in this matrix integral is like inserting the trace of e to the sigma 0. And now this is not so trivial, but this is quite easy. So this is how you actually calculate Wilson loops with localization. You, instead of calculating the integral as it comes from the localization, you have to insert something else, and this insertion is related to the insertion of this operator in the path integral. Okay? And this is actually how you calculate Wilson loops in n equal 4. So since I already explained quite a bit of this, I wanted to mention a connection to the talks by Fernand. Okay? So this is so you can also, by the way, include Wilson loops in ABN theory using this kind of things. But you see that in four dimensions, the result is quite trivial. So three dimensions, in that sense, is much more interesting because it really has to give a non-trivial function. Okay, so how do we calculate in the matrix center? Well, now I want to present you very briefly two ways of doing this calculation, but I want to be brief, and probably I will actually explain you two methods, and one of them I will have probably we just will show you just the result. Now, remember that there are two expansions in this theory. There is the Toft expansion, large n, large k, n over k fix, and then there is what I call the M theory expansion, n large k fix. Okay. Now, the large n expansion can actually the Toft expansion is actually something that when you have a matrix integral of this type, you can work out quite in detail. And the first concrete results for doing exact Toft expansions in gauge theories were done actually in matrix model like this. This is the work of Bressani, Chicson, Parisian, Souverain, 1978. So you can actually use these techniques in order to solve this matrix model. But what I'm going to do here is actually I'm going to do the N-theory expansion. So what I'm going to present you is actually a way of mapping this matrix integral to an elementary problem in statistical mechanics. Now, this n equal to the 3/2 problem is actually a very basic problem in these theories, and you should have a simple answer, okay? So what I'm going to try to show you is an answer which I think is quite simple, and essentially, in the same way that when people computed anomalous dimension equal 4, they were mapping this problem to a spin chain, to a statistical mechanical problem, what I'm going to do is to map this problem of calculating this matrix integral to a statistical mechanical problem, which is quite simple, and then you can actually see the n to the 3/2 behavior in an easy way. Okay? Okay, so our starting point then has to be this crazy integral, and now we're trying to map it to a simpler system. Okay? And I will do that in maybe 10 minutes, and then the remaining 10 minutes I can tell you the results of the other method. Okay, maybe I'm going too fast, so maybe I just can stop a moment to see if at least the strategy is clear. So as I said, we have reduced drastically the problem, but still we have a problem to solve because, you know, nobody can actually see, clearly not. I cannot just see an n equal to the 3/2 from that integral, right? I don't know if you can, but I can't. So it's still a problem, unfortunately for me, because I started working on this problem exactly at this point, so it was so easy I wouldn't have made it into it. So.
One question.
Yes.
If you computed like with a computer
numerically. Yeah, you could say, okay, I don't care about analytic methods. I'm going to put this in the computer, fix k, take n very, very large, and see if I can match the log to this n equal to the 3/2 behavior. You could have done that, okay? Now, this is not as easy as it looks, because when n is large, this is a multidimensional integral, there is no way mathematica will actually give you a numerical answer. And I think now there is a group in Japan doing the calculation with Monte Carlo and testing the analytic results. But you have to really have to do some non-trivial Monte Carlo techniques. Because actually, let me tell you that this integral is quite nasty. Because it's not really Gaussian, there is no Gaussian decay because this is imaginary. Remember that Gs is 2 pi over k. So this integral is actually conditionally convergent. So this is the kind of numerical calculation that in Mathematica tells you oscillatory integrand, we cannot really go further. So is here analytical methods are actually quite important. This is not easy. But in principle, you could do it. Okay. So what I'm going to do is to map this problem of calculating this integral to an elementary problem in statistical mechanics, which is a one-dimensional gas, Fermi gas. Now, in order to do that, you need to know only two things. One is non-trivial piece of knowledge, but people who have worked on matrix integrals have known this identity for a while, which is, remember that in the ABA matrix integral, what you have is the square of this quantity, okay? But this quantity without the square can be written as a sum over permutations. You can just write this triple product as a sum over permutations with a sign depending on the signature of the permutation, and then what you have here is a 1 over product of cost of mu I minus nu sigma I. Okay? So this is an identity. But you see already a fermion, some sort of Fermi taste, because you have here a sign over permutations and a minus one statistics. Okay? Now the other thing you have to know is just this elementary Fourier transform. Okay? Which now if you do these two things, it turns out that the matrix integral I wrote before can be written itself as a sum over permutations of a single dimensional integral with a product of rows, where here you have the rows have two entries, xi and x of the permutation of I, and this matrix, you can write it quite explicitly, it just involves a bunch of hyperbolic cosines. Okay? Now, this formula, you can actually, it's a relatively easy exercise, and if you want to see the solution, there is a paper, another paper by Kapustin, Willick, and Jakob, where actually they use this kind of formulation to actually show that the path that this matrix integral was the same this partition function was the same as the partition function of n equal 8 superjammials for k equal 1. Because, you know, n equal 4 superjammials, which is the theory of ND2 brains, should give the same partition function with k equal 1 as the ABM theory. So this actually, this form of the matrix integral is actually the natural one that appears when you look, instead of looking at N2 brains, when you look at D2 brains. Okay? Anyway, this is just a technical, if you want at this level, is a technical messaging. And the claim, and this is something that you should have learned in your course of statistical mechanics, is that this is the canonical partition function of an ideal Fermi gas. Okay? Since not everybody has gone through this, let me review some elementary statistical mechanics to show you why is this so. Okay? So let's then go to statistical mechanics. Now, what is the canonical density matrix for n particles? Well, in the lectures by Takayanagi, we were exposed to this kind of operators, is e to the minus the Hamiltonian, and you have just distinguishable particles. Just in order to get the matrix element for n particles, just sandwich this guy between the n particle positions and n particle positions prime. Okay, this is just the matrix element for a general density matrix. Now, this is if you have distinguishable particles. If you have indistinguishable particles, you have to project this onto the space of symmetric wave functions. Okay. And in order to do that, you have to use this operator, P, which is 1 over n factorial, and the sum over all possible permutations of the permutation sigma with the appropriate sign. So if you have n fermions, you can calculate the density matrix starting from the fermions as if they were distinguishable particles by symmetrizing the wave functions. This you know, I guess you more or less know, all of you, from statistical mechanics. And then the Fermi density matrix is just the sum over anti-symmetrizations, and you can easily see that you only have to anti-symmetrize one of the set of variables, because if you anti-symmetrize both, since P is a projector, it will give you the same result. So it's enough to anti-symmetrize on one side. Okay? You want P commutes with the Hamiltonian, so anti-symmetrizing on both sides is equivalent to symmetrizing on the other side, because P can jump over the Hamiltonian, and P square is equal to P, because P is a projector. Okay? So you have this expression here. So you notice already that, you know, this has the same flavor as the partition function had before. But now there is a very important simplification. And one very important simplification is that if you have a system of non-interacting particles, the density matrix factorizes completely. Okay? So distinguishable particles, essentially, only talks to to the other. And the matrix factorizes in a product of n density matrix, and this guy, rho xx prime, is just the one particle density matrix. Okay? So the conclusion is that if you have an ideal Fermi gas, the partition function is just the integral over the density matrix. The density matrix is the sum over all possible permutations, but since the gas is ideal, it factorizes. So you see that the expression I get at the end is exactly the same one that I was showing you before for this matrix integral. So the matrix integral of this theory is equal to the matrix is equal to the partition function, canonical partition function, of an ideal Fermi gas. Okay? So it cannot be simpler than that. And n, which was the rank of the Gauss group, is now the number of particles in this gas. So now, if you have an ideal Fermi gas, the only thing you have to know, the only thing you have to do is to solve the one particle problem. You have a gas of non-interacting particles. As soon as you know how to diagonalize the Hamiltonian, you are done. There are no interactions in the game. I mean, the hard part of condensed matter is to take into account interactions. You have ideal gases, this is very simple. Still, the problem is not completely simple because this one particle Hamiltonian can be complicated. I mean, diagonalizing the Schrödinger equation for an arbitrary potential is very hard, right? So this is the only source of complexity of the problem. Now, what is the potential? Well, this is what defines my density matrix. And this is what defines my density matrix in this particular problem. So I have to be able to extract a potential from here, from this expression. This is not very complicated. It has some twists in it. But essentially, what you can see is that you can write this using... This is a one-dimensional problem. So the Hamiltonian is only going to involve one impulse, one momentum, and one position. And you can see that it's given by this product of operators, where essentially the potential and the kinetic energy can be read from this inverse cost that we're appearing there. Okay? So Q and P are position and momentum operators, and they commute in the standard way. And there is a very interesting catch here, which is that H bar of the problem is K. Okay? So K was the level of Trin-Simons theory, and this is the H bar of this problem. So what we are saying here is that the ABM matrix integral is equal to the partition function of a Fermi gas, where n becomes the number of fermions, and k becomes h bar. So this is very interesting, because it means that semi-classical limit here is k very small, which is actually the strong coupling regime of the tight 2D theory. Okay? Now, k was integers, yes, but at this level I'm not worried about the integrality properties. You will see that actually... You will see that this is that actually doesn't lead to any problem. Now, this is a slightly complicated Hamiltonian because it has H-bar corrections, but essentially what you have is a non-trivial kinetic term and non-trivial potential. Okay? But this is just a Hamiltonian that you can work it with it in quantum mechanics. So actually, if this is, I'm showing the shape of this function, so at very large energies, when P and Q are both very large, what you have is actually much simpler. It's just the kinetic term is just an ultra-relativistic Fermi gas, and the potential is just a linear potential. So what you have here is an ultra-relativistic Fermi gas in a linearly confining potential. So you have reduced the problem to something really quite simple. And now, what happens, I don't know if you have done many exercises with Fermi gases, but when you put a Fermi gas in external potential, you get all kinds of scalings with n. So you can get n squared, but you can get n to the 5/3. I mean, this is something that is quite simple to see, that if you have a non-trivial potential even in an ideal gas, the scalings with n can be very, very, very general. Now, it's very easy actually to see that this type of potential will give you an scaling of the free energy with n to the 3/2. It's actually an exercise that you could have in undergrad statistical mechanics. But let me actually give you some tips of how you do this. Well, when you have a Fermi gas, the standard way to do it, to solve this problem in the large n limit, is to go to the grand canonical ensemble, because this is how to actually you get rid of all these n over permutations. So you just look at the grand canonical potential, and you introduce a chemical potential, mu, and then the fugacity is just the exponential of mu. So you have to, in a sense, consider these matrix integrals, but for all possible n. But you know how to do this calculation, right? I mean, you know that the easiest way is to look at the average occupation number, n is the derivative of u with respect to mu. And then once you have calculated this, the free energy is just the Legendre transform of this potential. This is kind of undergrad statistical mechanics. Now, the usual way you actually calculate this is by using the occupation number formalism. This is the standard formula for n for a Fermi gas. You have here a density of states. And here you have the Fermi occupation number. But actually, as it will turn out to, as you will see very clearly, we're interested in the large n limit. And here the large n limit means energy and chemical potential are very large. So this is actually the zero temperature limit of a Fermi gas. It's actually very easy to see, but when E is very large and mu is very large, it's like the gas was a very low temperature. So you really have a Fermi surface. And this, n, is just the number of states which have energy up to mu. where mu is now the Fermi level of the system. Okay? So this is an approximation which actually will be turn out to be very good at large n. And now you just have to calculate the number of states in this Fermi gas up to a given Fermi level, so you just have to see what is the Fermi surface of the gas. This is the only thing you have to see. You just have to see what is the Fermi surface for this gas, but the Fermi surface at large energies is just the Fermi surface for this Hamiltonian. So you just draw it. This is the Fermi surface, it's sort of a square, and you know that the number of states is the volume of phase space divided by the area of an elementary cell in phase space. You do the calculations, this is again trivial statistical mechanics, and you get on your nose the n to the 3 house behavior with the right coefficient. Okay? So this is one way to see that ABN theory indeed not only scales with n to the 3 house, but you get on your nose the right coefficient. I'm not going through the details, but believe me, this is something that I could, I have actually an exam of statistical mechanics tomorrow for my students, and I could give this as a question in the exam. I don't know how many of them would pass it, but you know, this is conceivably something that they could actually look at. Okay? No, this is really quite simple. It's really elementary statistical mechanics. There are some twists around, but you know, and I think it's very nice that you know there is really an elementary derivation of this thing. This is really elementary. I cannot think of something more elementary than this. Okay. Anyway, so this is an approach. I'm going to. So this actually tells you that the grand canonical potential is cubic in mu, and this is actually what is behind the n to the 3 house, is that this is cubic, and. And then one beautiful aspect of this formula is that you can systematically compute corrections, and you can actually compute the whole grand canonical potential. You have sublimiting terms and so on. So this is really something that is under control. But you know, at large n and thick scale, we have already derived it. So this shows that ABN theory displaces n to the 3 house behavior. Now it's clear. Now this is not, in a sense, as I said, this is n theory point of view. You want n is large. We are taking a thermodynamic limit, but k, well, k a priori should be small because we are doing a semi-classical limit, but actually you can see that this expression, for example, is exact for any k. So you can see that actually at large n, this actually is exact in k. So actually this is really M-theory expansion. As I said, there is the other point of view, which is the original one I was telling you about, which is this top expansion. So let me forget about this, and let's go back to our perturbative result for the planar free energy. Okay? Now, remember how we computed this. We computed this at one loop in perturbation theory in this ABN theory, right? Now, if one way to actually get this lambda to the 3 halves is the following. You take all possible loops. You just restrict to planar diagrams. You calculate all loops at all planar diagrams at any loops, you sum them up, and then when you sum them up and you go to large lambda, you should be able to find this 1 over square root of lambda that we were finding. Remember that n to the 3 halves here in this top expansion meant having something like 1 over square root of lambda for f0. So that's the point of view that you can also use. You just sum all these diagrams. Now, of course, in gauge theory, in the original ABN theory, this is tough. In the matrix model, well, at least you don't have to do nasty Feynman integrations. You can just do numerical integrations. And actually, you can do the calculation at 2 loops, the calculation at 3 loops. You can actually calculate perturbatively in this matrix model, and you could push it quite far. But what we have to do is actually to resum this expansion. And you see that this series here, starting at 2 loops, this one should be analytic at lambda equals 0, by the general argument that I told you. Now, of course, doing this by hand, nobody can do it, okay? But, as I mentioned before, there are some techniques that were introduced in the late 70s by Bresanitz, Gramparisi, and Soubert, which appropriately generalized allow you to do this resummation. So the only thing I'm going to do is to show you the result, and then I'm done, okay? But actually, the previous calculation I was doing was quite elementary, was just doing this Fermi gas thing, so this is why I decided to present it to you, because this is something that one can understand. I mean, maybe I was a little bit too fast, but if you think about it half an hour, you will see it's very easy. Well, this is quite hard. I mean, even after you reduce the Pronto matrix integral, you know, doing this resummation exactly is quite non-trivial. But, so I'm skipping all the details.
of how to get this, let me just show you the result, okay?
The result is this. The result is that you find two equations, one for lambda and one for the derivative with respect to lambda of this planar free energy. You have to introduce an extra parameter, forget about this. You have to introduce an extra parameter, but the answer is given by these two equations. So this is the complete answer. And the complete answer, this is the resummation. This includes the resummation. And what you have to do is, here you span around kappa equals zero, lambda. You span also here around kappa equals zero, and then you invert this series and you plug it in here, and you get the expansion of this thing as a function of lambda. So this is really a mess. But I only want to make two comments. First of all, the analyticity structure. Remember that I told you that this guy should be analytic in lambda around lambda equals zero. Now, the functions that appear here, this is a hypergeometric function, this is a major function, but the analyticity is very clear here. So remember that hypergeometric functions are, so you have an hypergeometric functions, they are analytic at the origin. They are analytic at the origin, and then they have a branch cut starting at z equal 1, right? In the standard notation. Now, if you look at this solution, you see that there is, you look, for example, at these two functions, you see that there are analytic around the, let's think about this in terms of the kappa plane, and let me here write the lambda plane. So you see that the cut of these functions is when this guy is 1. This is 1 when kappa is 4i or minus 4i. So in the kappa plane, what you have is two branch cuts here, starting here, and you have an analyticity domain. Okay? Now, when you go to the lambda plane, this point maps actually to a point in the imaginary axis. This also goes to a point in the imaginary axis. So here you have branch cuts, but you have an analyticity domain around lambda equals zero. So you see that these functions define, these two pair of equations define an analytic function in the lambda plane where there is a singularity in the imaginary axis. There are singularities in the imaginary axis. So even though this series that I wrote you before, this series has a finite radius of convergence around lambda equals zero, since I have the singularities in the imaginary axis, I should be able to analytically continue to large lambda. Okay? So you do that, and you can even plot it. And the exact function d lambda of f0, actually, I plot it like this. I have to say that here I use a different normalization. So here, my f0 is defining an expansion in gs minus square, but this is, again, up to a power of lambda, is the same thing. Is the function that I was introducing before. It's just differing in an overall power of lambda. And this is the blue line is the exact result. The red line is the supergravity result. And the green line is the one-loop result that I was showing you before. So you see, when lambda is zero, the one-loop result is very good. But here, as lambda reaches 0.2 or something like that, starts being less and less good as compared to the exact result. The supergravity calculation, so the gravity calculation, which gives you this 1 over square root of lambda, is very good as lambda, when lambda is large. But as lambda becomes smaller, it starts differing from it. So this is actually the weak, strong coupling interpolating function. A weak coupling agrees with one loop, a strong coupling agrees with supergravity, and interpolates smoothly between these two functions. So it's the full solution to the problem of the planar free energy. And of course, you can see that it gives you this 1 over square root of lambda with the right coefficient again. Okay? So I guess I should be on the point of finishing my exposition. Let me maybe mention the last result. Now here, as you see, here you have a lot of information. This is not just the large lambda result. This is the lambda result with all corrections. So remember that I was saying at the very beginning of these lectures that in principle lambda is like is related to 1 over h bar square. It's like the h bar of the Wolfshift theory. So if you include corrections in lambda, they should come from instantons and from loops. So there will be corrections. So let me write this here. So there are, so I think this is what I was writing here. So lambda is of the order of the words in H bar. So a correction in H bar is a correction in this Worksheet theory, is a correction in 1 over square root of lambda, and a non-perturbative correction in minus 1 over H bar is actually a correction in e to the minus square root of lambda. So we should expect this exact formula when you span it around very large lambda to give you the supergravity result plus, so the classical result plus all these corrections. And indeed it does. You can actually see that it has the right coefficient. Here you have n to the 3 halves with some sieve. And now you have here, if you write it in terms of n over k, it has this kind of corrections, which actually correspond to non-perturbative corrections in 1 over alpha prime, eh? Or if you want, in minus square root of lambda. Okay? So this is a theory in which you have non-trivial exponentially small corrections in the Worksheet theory. Oops. And these are due, this would be due actually to Worksheet instantons. And this is actually something very new as compared to ADS5. And this is due to the fact that this, in this type 2A background, CP3, there is a small sphere. And then strings can wrap this small sphere inside CP3. And then it should give you this type of correction. Now, in the M-theory expansion that I was looking at before using this Fermi-Gauss approach, you find pretty much the same leading term. But then your exponentially small corrections have a different scaling. Here they scale like n over k, square root of n over k, and here they scale like k times n. Now this is naturally a two-dimensional object, but you can see from the dictionary I showed you before that this is actually a natural three-dimensional object. So this would be related to membranes in M theory. Okay? So you see that from this kind of matrix model, you get an amazing amount of information about non-perturbative effects. In the type 2A expansion, you get Worksheet instantons, you get non-trivial Worksheet configurations, and in N-theory expansion, you get actually membrane configurations. So you see that this model defines really the full geometric information containing these quantities, which is actually quite big. So I have focused very much on this leading term, this n to the 3 halves, but you see that there is a lot of stuff here, which is still to be understood. Okay? So let me finish here, and then I can take questions.
We have time for some questions.
Maybe this was a little bit too fast. Sorry, but...
Yes, can you use the mic, please?
So... Can you do the same calculation with finite temperature, for example, S1 times S2 or S1 times S3?
No, for finite temperature, you are doomed to fail because this breaks supersymmetry. So supersymmetry is breaking by the boundary conditions. And then essentially what happens is the following. Essentially what happens is that your Lagrangian is no longer invariant under the supersymmetry transformations. So the original hypothesis that we use in order to do this localization is that we had to have a Grassmannian symmetry in the theory which was annihilating the action. So the action was invariant under the Grassmannian symmetry. When finite temperature, this doesn't happen. So all the power of supersymmetry essentially breaks down. So I don't know how to do a calculation like this at finite temperature. There might be a way of using some inspiration from this, but on your nose it just fails down. It's slightly different. It's slightly different because you have to use... Remember how I calculated this in the... I mean, I don't remember now its that value, but a priori it's different. It's also n to the 3 halves, but this is trivial because this comes from the G Newton. I mean, G Newton already gives you the 3 halves. Now, what you have to do now is to calculate the Einstein-Hilbert action evaluated not in ADS4, but on the Euclidean Schwarzschild-Black hole of ADS4. And this will give you a different value in general. Okay.
So I was just wondering if that is just basically related to the coefficients.
I don't remember. I cannot tell you from the top of my head, but in principle the result should... I mean, it's a number. They only differ in a number. I guess everything else is equal, but the number is different because it comes from evaluating a different action. Yes?
Yes, one question there. Do you, from this calculation, either the Fermi-Gauss or the...
or the Toft expansion, do you get any physical idea as to how the gauge degrees of freedom reorganize themselves in such a way that the free energy has this n to the 3 half?
Well, in the Toft expansion, you don't see it very well. Now, in the Fermi gas, you could say that you could say the following way. You could think that actually, if you think about how you do this calculation, remember how this started. I started with this matrix integral, and then I was putting these factors coming from all these vector multiples and so on. What you can do is the following: you can think about the D-brains that actually the D-brain construction of this theory, and you can see that all these factors that are getting into the matrix integral come from the particular configuration of D-brains that you have to use in order to engineer the ABN theory. So in a sense, what this kind of calculation is telling you is that these D-brains are behaving as some sort of Fermi system. That D-brains behave as fermions, this you can see in other contexts. So what seems to be happening here is that these D-brains that or N2-brains that lead to the ABN theory, actually at the end of the day, when you actually calculate their interactions, they behave like a Fermi gas. And then, you know, the growth, the reorganization of the degrees of freedom is the standard one that you have for a Fermi gas of this type. So this is the closest thing I can give you to a picture of the interaction. It seems that these degrees of freedom become effectively one-dimensional and effectively fermionic, and effectively they have this kinetic turn and potential. So this would be, for me, the closest thing to a physical picture. But I guess one can try to make this more concrete.
Because this is a bulk picture,
is the boundary picture. This is the gauge theory picture. This is what comes from the localization calculation in the gauge theory. So this is the gauge theory picture. The fermion picture is a gauge theory picture.
No, but you were computing the free energy in the Trans-Simon theory.
In the
ABJM
yes,
theory.
Yes,
so it's
yes.
A Trans-Simon theory. So basically what you're still saying is that a strong coupling, this the degrees of freedom of this Trans-Simon theory, which are a priori just Trans-Simon fields and some extra fermions and so on, they end up behaving as if they were
a
Fermi gas.
Yes, yeah, this is what I'm saying, yeah.
Okay, any other urgent question? Is it urgent? Okay, please.
Just for theories with less supersymmetry, do you still get a Fermi gas? And if so, what kind of Hamiltonian does it?
Okay, so for n equal 3 theories, you still get a Fermi gas. So you can go from n equal 6. This is n equal 6. So if you go to n equal 3, you still get a Fermi gas. As if you break enough supersymmetry and you get n equal 2, then you have an interacting Fermi gas. And this is a much harder problem. This is actually the case in which your anomalous dimension is no longer protected. So the way you see this effect in this picture is that the Fermi gas start having a short-range interaction between the fermions. So the system becomes interacting. Now, a large chain, many times interacting systems, you can still use some collective picture to solve it. And what you can see is that there is a very old method to treat interacting Fermi systems, which is Thomas Fermi approximation. Maybe you study this in atomic physics. You have a very large atom with lots of fermions, use Thomas Fermi approximation, and then you get a kind of rough picture of the energy of the system. If you apply the Thomas Fermi picture to this interacting Fermi gas, you still recover the n2 3 halves behavior. Now, getting corrections is much harder because you have to go, you know, a large chain, essentially semi-classical physics, is essentially correct. So even if the gas is interacting, you can find this effective Thomas Fermi picture, so things go well. Mm-hmm. But, for example, this detailed calculation of the corrections to the 1 over n expansion that you are able to in the free Fermi system, you cannot do it in the interacting Fermi system easily. At least I don't know how to do it easily.
Okay, I suggest we suggest any further discussion. We defer any further discussion to the tutorials, so let's thank Marcus for the beautiful set of lectures again.